because Jesus was a waymaker. And so when we start talking about a series of being a waymaker, Jesus, it's very biblical. And so I hope that, and why I'm doing it in first person is because we read the Bible all the time, many of us. We read about these characters, and they aren't real to us. We just read it through, and it says, the man was blind from birth, and he was 40 years old. It never impacts us. And so I hope that you, from how we handle it today, will have a connection with this man for whom Jesus made a way. And you would also celebrate the Waymaker. Would you pray with me, please? Father, we thank you so much for your word. And I pray that the words of my mouth, the thoughts of our hearts, would be pleasing in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I'm fully aware that if yesterday hadn't happened, I wouldn't be talking to you today. I'm fully aware that if yesterday hadn't happened, you could have walked into our neighborhood, you could have walked into our community, and you would have not noticed me. Or maybe one or two of you who really had a loving heart would notice me sitting there begging, and you may have dropped a few coins on my blanket there. But most of you wouldn't have noticed me. But I want you to understand something did happen yesterday that changed everything. Oh, I am so sorry. I forgot to tell you my name. You see, I was given a name. My parents named me just like every other parent. But you know what? When you are born blind, and after 40 years, your name changes. You see, now, for a long, long time, I've been called sinner. Because there's an obvious connection between being born blind and sin. Someone had to have sinned. And all my life, the debate has been, was it my parents who sinned or was it me that sinned in my mother's womb? And so I became known as sinner. And then, because you're blind, you become known as the blind man. That's how I was described. If you walked into town, you would see the crippled man, the deaf man, and the blind man. That's what they called me. And then, as time passed, of course, and I grew older, and I had to provide for myself. One of the problems is when you're blind, you can't provide for yourself. And I became called the beggar. So I was a sinful, blind beggar. That's what I was. But this day would be different. This day would be so different. So I got up just like every other morning. And of course, I have been born blind. I have never seen light. I have never seen my mother's face. I have never seen my father's hands working. I could never be his apprentice. I have never seen a sunrise or a sunset. I have never seen the color blue. If you told me something was blue yesterday, I wouldn't have known at all what you were saying. I was born blind. I have nothing to relate to. I don't know yellow. I don't know orange. I don't know blue. This came home to me one day when I was a child. My parents had taken me outside So I could feel the warmth of the sun. You know, I could feel the warmth of the sun, but I couldn't see anything the sun lit. And while I was out there, I heard two or three boys, maybe four, I'm not sure. You see, I was born blind. I couldn't see. And I heard them laughing, and you could tell. And by the way, I am blind. I'm not deaf. And people talk about me, and they, when I'm there, and they act like I can't hear them. Well, I could hear these boys very well because my senses compensated. And they were talking, and one of them said, "Wait, look at that beautiful butterfly. Let's catch it." I don't know beautiful. I don't know butterfly. And I certainly can't catch it. And then the other one said, "The sky is so blue. It is so pretty. I don't know blue. And I don't know pretty." All I know is black. All I know is darkness. And that is all I have known for 40 years. Well, this day was going to be all different. It was going to be so wild. Matter of fact, I'm going to tell you exactly what happened, but you probably won't believe me. So I got up and I got my clothes and I took my walking cane and I started out, and I know the route to where I sit and I know the smells, and I know I walked by this place where this lady bakes a bread for me, and she gives it to me, and I give her a coin, and she gives me change back if possible, and I trust her. And so I make my way around the corner and I find my spot and I sit down and I put out my blanket waiting for people to be generous. And I've been sitting there for a little while, and people have come by. I haven't heard any coins drop, but I'm sitting there, and all of a sudden I hear a familiar sound. And that sound is that of a rabbi and his disciples. And it's a known sound. They're asking him questions, and he's answering, and they talk among themselves. And many times they'll look at me, and they'll talk and act like I'm not even there. And I can hear what they say. And usually it's involved with the word sinner or blind man or beggar. So this group was coming, and I expected the same thing. And sure enough, one of the disciples said, "Rabbi, who sinned? This man or his parents that he was born blind?" I heard every word of it. Why? Why does it have to be? Why did these disciples come up with two alternatives, either I sin or my parents sin? Well, I knew the answer the rabbi was going to give. He's going to do one of two things. Number one, he was going to ask them the question back, because he had no idea what to say. Or he was going to take a chance and pick one. I could have told him what he would say, but this rabbi was different, and I didn't even begin to know how different at this time, but this rabbi was different. You know what he said? He said this: "Neither this man nor his parents sinned." He is in this condition. He has been blind for 40 years so the works of God could be displayed through him. Now, folks, what does that mean? I mean, I've heard other rabbis and other people, and no one had ever said neither. And no one had ever said, he's this condition, he's blind from birth for 40 years, so that the works of God can be displayed in him. Now that was amazing. Then he went on to say some incredible things. He says, as long as it's day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I'm in the world, I am the light of the world. I don't know what that means. Certainly didn't know then. I do know now. Then something absolutely crazy happened. He spit on the ground. And he took the spit and made mud. And then he took that mud and he put it on my eyes. And then he said to me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash your eyes. That's all he said. Now think about that with me. Go to the pool. I'm blind. How do I get there? Well, there's something about him. I just got up and I started kind of towards the direction I thought it was, and I would ask somebody and they would help me along the way, and someone would say, you'd go that way, and they'd turn me in the right, and eventually I got to the pool, and there were 5 levels of steps down to that pool, and they helped me down there. You know what I realize now? I didn't know then. God had prepared a way for me to get there through people. You know, this rabbi asked me to go. Didn't really know how, and there was a way. Well, I got there and knelt by the pool, and I splashed the water on my face, and I cleaned the mud off, and then I opened my eyes, and I saw for the first time, I saw blue. Now, it could have been yellow to me. I didn't know what you called it, but it was blue. The sky. I saw the water. I saw the stones of the fountain. I saw the dust. I saw the people. I saw my hands for the first time. I saw my clothing. I saw sun. And you know what? I didn't yell. I didn't run around crazy. I just sat there looking around, both crying and laughing. I was blind. I was blind for 40 years. And now I am flooded with light. Now I can see. So I got up. I didn't need help getting back. I started walking. And I thought, we're going to have a party when I get back. Everybody's going to be so happy that I can see. And so eventually I got back home. I got to my neighborhood. And as I was walking and talking, I found out that the rabbi's name was Jesus. So I got to my neighborhood and I met my neighbors. And then an argument broke out. No one said, we're so grateful you can hear, you can see, we're so grateful that your sight has been restored. How does it feel to see after 40 years? None of that. One side was arguing, is that the sinful blind beggar seeing? Yeah, that's me. And the other side was saying, oh no, that's not him. That's just someone who has an uncanny resemblance to him. No, I said, it really is me. It's me. I was the blind man. And I came back seeing. And I found out they did not know what to do with me. You know what to do with this blind man. You put him by the road and let him beg. What do you do with a seeing man? So then they asked me, what happened? How do those dead eyes see? And then I told them the story. This rabbi, I now know his name's Jesus. He came by, he spit on the ground, and then he rubbed the stuff in my eyes, the mud, and then he sent me to the pool of Siloam, and I went there, I washed it off, and then I could see. Well, where is this guy? I don't know. I don't know where he went. All I know is this, I was blind, but now I see. That's all I know. Well, they decided that I needed to go see the Pharisees. That it was real important that the Pharisees investigate this. And so when I get in front of the Pharisees, there is a problem. And not only are my neighbors arguing over who I am, the Pharisees are arguing over who Jesus is. It's most incredible. Not one Pharisee said, we're so glad you can see. Not one. One side was saying, this man is not from God. This man who touched your eyes because he does not keep the Sabbath. Now I've got to tell you the rule. The Pharisees had an oral tradition that you could not work on Sunday. And one of those oral traditions was you could not spit on Sunday. Because if you spit on the Sabbath, I'm sorry, it wasn't Sunday, it was the Sabbath. If you spit on the Sabbath, the spit may roll down and create mud, and it's unlawful for you to create mud on the Sabbath. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I was blind for 40 years. And this man made mud, put it on my eyes, I washed it off, and I could see. I don't care if it was on the Sabbath. All I know is this, I was blind and now I'm seeing. Well, the other side was saying, how can a sinner perform such a miracle, make such a way? And then they were arguing and then they looked at me and they said, well, what do you say? What do I say? Let's say he's a prophet. Jesus is a prophet. But they didn't believe me. They didn't believe me that I was born blind. And so they called my parents. And they bring my parents in this meeting with the Pharisees. And they asked my parents, is this your son? And was he born blind? And my mom and dad say, this is what we know. Now, I got to tell you, the Pharisees had said they would excommunicate out of the synagogue anybody who professed good things about Jesus. So they ask him, is this your son? And was he born blind? They said, yes, we know two things. We know he is our son, and we know he was born blind. Now, how he sees, we don't know. But he's of age, ask him. They were fearful. And so the Pharisees turn around and look at him. And look at each other and look at me. And then they say this to me, give God glory. Tell the truth. We know this man is a sinner. And I said to them, whether he's a sinner or not, I do not know. All I know is I was blind, but now I see. That's all I know. Well, what did he do and how did he do it? Do you really want to know? I have already told you. He spit on the ground and he made a mud and he put it on my eyes and I went to the pool and then I could see. I've already told you, but you do not listen. And then I thought I would interject some humor into the conversation. It was pretty tense. It was pretty tight. A bad, bad idea. I said, do you want to become his disciples? Oh, I wish I hadn't said that. Then they started insulting me. They said, aha, we know now you are one of this guy's disciples. We are disciples of Moses. We know where Moses came from. We have no idea where this man came from. And then I just couldn't shut up. I said this. I said, that's interesting. It's fascinating. This man healed me, who was blind for 40 years from birth. No one has ever done that. It is impossible. And you don't know where he's from. You're the teachers of Israel. And you have taught us that God doesn't listen to people that are sinful. He only listens to those who are obedient and righteous. And you don't know where he's from? Then they said, you are a sinner. You were steeped in sin at birth. How would you dare teach us? And then they kicked me out of the synagogue. I was excommunicated. And all I did was tell them that I was blind from birth for 40 years, and now I can see. So I walk out of the meeting and walking down the street, and all of a sudden, the rabbi, Jesus, he stopped me. And I realized who he was. And this is the first time I'd ever seen him. And he looked so loving, but so serious. And he looked at me and he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? And I said, who is he? I want to. And he looked at me and he said, you have seen him, and the one you're talking to is him. And then, ladies and gentlemen, the second miracle of the day, which far outweighs the first one, happened, and my eyes were opened spiritually and my spiritual blindness were gone, and I saw the Son of Man, and I fell on my face and worshiped him. I fell on my face and worshiped him. Not only had he given me physical sight, he had given me spiritual sight. All my blindness was gone. Now later he had a conversation with the Pharisees and talked to them about how they had been blinded by the light and how they were still in their sins. But I want to stop here and tell you something that's very important to me. You want to know what my name is now? My name is no longer sinner. My name is forgiven. My name is no longer the blind man. My name is the seeing man. And my name no longer is beggar. My name is a child of the King. Because I was blind, but now I see. And that's what Jesus Christ can do for a blind man who was blind from birth for 40 years. Amen. Now, I just want to share with you three or four things that come out of the story, and then we'll go. First of all, Jesus said to the blind man that he was blind for 40 years so that the works of God could be displayed in him. That's Jesus Christ's job. And every one of us who is a believer in Jesus Christ, we are people in whom the works of God can be displayed. That is an incredible privilege. But I want you to know that he was blind for 40 years so that that second he could wash his eyes and see to bring glory to God. Now, don't miss this as we talk about the way, Jesus being a waymaker. Sometimes Jesus uses our pain and our suffering so that he can provide a way for someone else. Do I need to illustrate it? Jesus. Jesus became the way through pain and suffering. Are you willing to be blind for 40 years if God can show someone else the way through you? Now, he had no choice. I know that. The problem is we have a choice. Second thing I just want to say is the Lord deals with us as individuals. The Lord deals with us as individuals. Here was a blind man. He blind from birth. I don't know how many blind men were in Jerusalem that day. But the book of John is all about individuals. If you read the book of John, one of the things that John wants to do is to show us that Jesus was the Son of God and that he cares for individuals. So you start out with Nicodemus. You go to the woman at the well. Then there's the lame man in chapter 5. And the blind man. God deals with us as individuals. And all of us in this room will have a time when Jesus Christ needs to provide a way for us. Sometimes he'll use the suffering of others to provide that way. Sometimes it may be reversed. But every one of us are unique. And whatever our desperate situation is, God wants to to show his work and to display his work through you and through the situation. I don't care how bad it is. And this is the most important one, probably. The ultimate healing for the blind man was seeing the glory of God and realizing that Jesus was indeed the way maker. When you read John and you read a miracle, you understand the miracle is always a means. It's never the end. The miracle of restoring the physical sight of the person was a means to the ultimate end of him receiving spiritual sight. Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. And if he could provide a way of sight for a man and then provide a way of spiritual sight, he would do that. The greatest miracle was the fact that he received his spiritual sight. He knew who Jesus was. And he did the only thing you can do when you figure out who he is. He fell down and worshiped him. But the title of my message today is Blinded by the Light. You see, the Pharisees were blinded by the light of Jesus. They couldn't see it. They were more concerned with spitting on the Sabbath than the Son of God. They were more concerned about their rules and their trappings than they were the Son of God. And Jesus said, listen, this man was blind. He didn't have all the privileges you had. You had parents. You were given light. You were given the opportunity to follow a rabbi, and you study the scriptures, and you memorize the Torah, and you have all these light, but you're still blind, even though you have light. You've not lived up to the light. The light of the glory of God blinded you. It did not call you to salvation. And you have no excuse. You know, I fear that for us in this country. I fear this for our children. I fear this for pastors like me. We have handled the holy things. People hear the gospel over and over. They see the gospel of light. And it is my fear that the light of the gospel has blinded them and they're dead in their trespasses and sin. We need to pray that the Waymaker will open their eyes so they can see the glory of God, not be blinded by it. This is an incredible story. It all happened because the light of the world, Jesus Christ, made himself known to poor sinners just like you and me. For one man, it had been pitch black darkness all of his life. He'd never seen his mother or father. He'd never seen his friends nor those in his community. As a child, he would have been provoked and teased by children who would never see. Dark, dark, always night, always shut off from seeing what is around him. He can feel the heat and warmth of the sun, but he never seen anything around him lit up by the sun. The man was blind from birth with no means to support himself. He was a constant embarrassment and reminder to the community of their failure to keep the hurting and the weak. A poor blind beggar, a weak blind vessel. Now watch this. Who Jesus uses to reveal a greater darkness, a greater problem of the community. The problem of blindness in the heart. For the Pharisees, they had the privilege of light all their lives under the law. They were God's chosen people and they were blind. God comes through the gospel of Christ Jesus and comes into the deep, dark quarters and caverns of our cold hearts to warm them and to say to them, let there be light. and arise, shine, for the light has come. That's what he did for you. That's what he did for me. He found us, and he went into those deep, dark parts of our heart and said, let there be light. So the question today is this. Do you believe Jesus is the Son of Man? Do you believe Jesus is the light of the world? Have you received him as your Savior? Can you say along with this poor blind man, I was blind, now I see. I was spiritually dead, and now I am alive. I was lost, but now I'm found. And I was alienated from God, and now I'm his friend. If not, don't let the light of the gospel blind you to the truth that you need a Savior. That you need a Savior. Would you pray with me, please?